Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching The Big Picture with me, Frank Pereira. The Supreme Court sentenced a High Court judge to 6 months in prison on charges of contempt on Tuesday, a first for a serving judicial officer in what has been an unprecedented face-off in the upper judiciary over alleged corruption. The move against Justice C.S. Karnan of the Calcutta High Court came after a months-long and sometimes farcical standoff with the top court that saw the two sides issuing a string of orders against each other. Karnan's arrest orders came a day after he sentenced Chief Justice of India, J.S. Keher, and six other judges of the Supreme Court to 5 years in jail under the SCST Act. The court also ordered the media to keep away from reporting anything on him. On this edition of The Big Picture, we will take a closer look at the Justice Karnan saga and its implication on the judicial system. Joining me on the program today are Justice S.N. Dhingra, former judge, Delhi High Court, Satya Prakash, legal editor, The Tribune, Indra Jai Singh, senior advocate of the Supreme Court, and K.N. Balgopal, former advocate general of Nagaland and senior advocate of the Supreme Court. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program. Justice, I'd like to begin with you because we don't really want to be in soup or in trouble or get in any trouble with the Supreme Court because there is a gag order as far as this particular issue is concerned. What is it that we can cover? What is it that we can't cover?
See, you can't publish anything which Mr. Karnan says. As per Supreme Court order, all his statements on this issue, etc., they cannot be published. But there is no ban on discussing the implications of this judgment and the circumstances under which this has been passed, etc.
So, Justice, how do you look at this whole saga? I mean, is it something that... Have you seen anything like this in your long legal career?
See, I have not seen because this is, as you say and as everybody says, that this is first time that a sitting
judge... But anything close to this?
Sitting judge has been punished. See, the extent to which Mr. Karnan has dragged this and the extent which he was given latitude by the Supreme Court has not been seen and it is unparalleled. Because this started not now. This started when Mr. Karnan barged into the courtroom of a division bench of Madras High Court, who was hearing a PIL, and started arguing a case in favor of, SCST candidates. Then, you see, at that time also, Justice Agarwal, who was Chief Justice, had written to Chief Justice of India that this is a conduct. Please take action, please transfer him. See, that should have been taken note of. See, a stitch in time saves nine.
Yes.
And if that should have been taken note of, that this is not the way a judge can behave, that while being a judge, he starts, he becomes an advocate, leaves the court, goes into another, before another bench, starts arguing, and then starts abusing. He did not abuse only one Chief Justice, but three Chief Justices.
Sure.
Justice Siddiqui, Justice Kaul, and Justice Agarwal. And he always used, because I am Dalit, I am being oppressed. You see, if a High Court judge, person of status of High Court judge, who is having independent powers under Constitution, says that he feels oppressed, then what you can expect of other high dignitaries in this country who also may belong to the same community and on every small thing they may say that we are oppressed.
I'm going to take that point that you're making forward.
So, his main plank has always been to use the Dalit card.
Okay. Is there a lot of casteism as far as the judiciary is concerned, Mr. Balgopal? Or is it just a one-off case as far as Karnan is concerned, a repeat offender, if you could call him that?
The allegation of caste, etc., that's quite microscopic in nature as far as higher judiciary is concerned. They've got nothing to do with it. The basic problem in Justice Karnan's case is that on 1st of May, the Supreme Court passed an order saying that from the tenure of Mr. Justice Kannan's press briefings and the purported judicial orders he was passing, the prima facie were of the opinion that he requires medical examination to ascertain the fact whether he is in a position to meet his defense in the case. This was very gracious on the part of the Supreme Court to come to this conclusion. Having come to this conclusion, notwithstanding the fact that Justice Kannan said that I don't want to be medically examined, you cannot presume that Justice Kannan is fit enough to defend his case. Because court prima facie found that he has to be examined. And once he says that I don't require to be examined, that does not mean that he doesn't require any assistance as far as his defense is concerned. I think if this question was correctly addressed, like if you see when you're traveling on the roadside and the police people try to challenge you for consuming alcohol, you say, I won't face the test. So that means there is an adverse inference that you have actually drunk. Likewise, in this case, when Justice Kannan was saying, I don't require any medical assistance, well, an adverse inference should have been drawn that he actually requires it. And having made that assessment, the court should have treated him the way a person who requires such assistance ought to have been treated.
Okay, so that's what the Supreme Court ought to have done so as to put an end to the subject then and there.
That would have added to the grace of the entire issue.
Sure.
Maybe permitting him to continue until his term comes to an end in June and put a quietus to the matter. And they also passed this gag order towards the end. They could have passed this order at the very instance. If one such order was passed at that instance, that purported judicial orders are being put in the press, maybe this type of situation would not have come.
Okay, sure.
So he deserved a treatment at least on those lines.
Sure. Ms. Indra Jaisingh, could the whole issue have been handled differently? And I want to take the point that Justice Dhingra was making earlier as well about how Justice Kannan is... This is not the first time that something like this has happened as far as Justice Kannan is concerned. He's done the same in the Madras High Court as well. So was it a systemic failure as well to ensure that he continued for this long?
I will just answer that question by saying the systemic failure happened when he was appointed, and that systemic failure points to the systemic shortcomings of the method of appointment. But I think the more important question for me is, does the Supreme Court of India have the jurisdiction to pass an order which results in the removal of a judge from the office of being a judge? As I see it, Parliament and Parliament alone has this power under Article 217 of the Constitution of India. And I don't think the Supreme Court can, in exercise of contempt jurisdiction, pass an order which has the effect of removing a judge from judicial office. Now, let me just tell you, suppose tomorrow a judge is accused of having taken money in a case pending before him. That would also be contempt of his own court. Would the Supreme Court then step in and say, we are taking contempt of court proceedings and removing him from judicial work? Will that not be a way of circumventing the Constitution? You can give any number of examples where judges commit acts of misconduct. I would like to give you another example. There have been judges who have been accused of sexually harassing women. They are still sitting as judges and dispensing justice. There's no contempt of court action taken against them. So I question not only the power, but also the manner in which this power is being exercised, both as being totally arbitrary and without any foundation in the Constitution.
Okay, I'm going to take the point that you're making forward with Justice Dhingra so that we get a legal perspective as well, complete legal perspective, a judge's perspective. Is that the case, Justice Dhingra? I mean, did the Supreme Court circumvent the Constitution?
You see, power to remove a judge is with the Parliament. There is no doubt about it. But to power to punish for contempt is with Supreme Court and not with Parliament.
So it was within the purview of the Supreme Court.
So it was within the purview of the Supreme Court. Now it is a criminal contempt, not civil contempt. And a judge is not immune from criminal law. If we follow the analogy of what Inder Jai Singh is saying, then a judge, despite committing rape and murder, continues to be a judge and cannot be sentenced and sent to prison. Because sending him to prison after convicting him for rape and murder would also amount to removing him from judge. If the parliament does not step in and does not impeach him even after he has committed crime, and which parliament has shown that it can refrain from impeaching, as it happened in a case of Mr. Ramaswamy, that parliament refused to impeach him despite sufficient evidence. Now, if parliament refuses to impeach, maybe on several grounds, I am not going into that, and a judge is sentenced for a crime, if sending him to jail amounts to removing, see, that is disastrous. Okay. And preposterous. I can't even think.
Yes.
That a judge committing crime is not sent to jail because he cannot be removed by the court, and sending him to jail shall amount to his removal.
Okay, sure. Let's take the discussion forward with Satya Prakash now.
Can I respond?
Okay, a quick response because I want to get my other guest in as well.
No, you can get your guest in. I'll respond after that.
No, please go ahead. Please go ahead. We are on you right now. Please go ahead, Ms. Jai Singh.
Okay. Okay, so there is a procedure prescribed by law for prosecuting a judge. No effort was made to follow that procedure. If it is alleged that he committed a criminal act, then there should have been an application for permission to prosecute him. That was not done. Secondly, why are we presuming that Parliament would not have impeached Karnan? Why that presumption? After all, the Attorney General of India stood up in court and said that he had committed a gross act of misconduct. If that is the case, why do we do not have any reason to believe that a party which enjoys a huge majority in Parliament would not have impeached him if the Supreme Court had said, well, this is a fit case which should go, and if it doesn't take more than 50 MPs to sign an impeachment motion, at least to get a fact finding where the judge then gets an opportunity to be heard by a committee of three persons as to whether or not he has committed an act of misconduct. So, of course, you know, I want to be very clearly, I don't want to be misunderstood as saying that I support what he did. No, my concern, I do believe that what he did was an act of misconduct. But I also believe, because I believe it was an act of misconduct, I also believe that this case should have gone to Parliament.
Okay, sure, fair enough. Let's take the discussion forward now. And Satya Prakash, can we just dismiss this as a one-off aberration, or is it a larger problem within the judiciary?
It's part of the larger problem because it started with his appointment. And the real problem lies in the collegium system, which is completely opaque. He was appointed through a collegium system. Three judges committee, the High Court Collegium recommended his name, Supreme Court Collegium approved, and he was appointed. So first mistake was committed when he was appointed. Second, when he committed misconduct in the Madras High Court, not just with one Chief Justice, with three Chief Justices, and thereafter, there are several instances where he has repeated such things. The Supreme Court judges, the collegium should have taken note of it, and a committee should have been set up, the matter should have been inquired into, and if it was misconduct, this would have recommended to the government to remove him, impeachment procedure. Every second stage also, they didn't do anything. Instead, he was transferred from Madras High Court to Calcutta High Court. Even there, he continued with his, I'm saying there was enough opportunity for the Supreme Court or Supreme Court judges, the collegium in particular, to conclude that this gentleman is committed misconduct as a judge and he is fit to be removed. Accordingly, the collegium should have recommended to the government to remove him. It has happened in the past in one judge incidentally, of Calcutta High Court, Justice Soumitra Sen, that's a different thing that he could not be impeached. But this was the course available. Having said that, as Ms. Indira Jaisingh said, nobody would support what Mr. Justice Karnan said.
Sorry.
Or did. But the manner in which the entire thing has been handled by the Supreme Court, it's difficult to appreciate that. For the reason that one has been pointed out by Ms. Jaisingh, that the power of contempt cannot be used in such a manner so as to remove a judge. That power solely rests with Parliament. That cannot be exercised by Supreme Court. I am reminded of a decision taken by Parliament in both the houses when they took the membership of 10 or 11 MPs in Cash for Query scam. Even that was, the Supreme Court upheld that. But I strongly feel that if we have a written constitution and there is no provision empowering either house to remove an MP, that should not be exercised by Parliament. Unfortunately, the Supreme Court approved that in a constitution bench verdict. Here also, the Supreme Court is creating a precedent, and God forbid, if tomorrow that is to be misused in future, then the entire system will go for a toss. Further, the Supreme Court has gagged the media. Before doing that, you are not just gagging media, you are also gagging the judge. I am saying he should have been given an opportunity to explain his position. I am taking a completely legal position. If you are taking away somebody's fundamental right to free speech, the person should have been given opportunity to be heard. On that count, he was never issued notice and heard. Media also, why shoot the messenger? We are not issuing such orders. So judiciary created such a situation and media is simply reporting that and we are being punished. We have a right to report and we assert that right. We should have been given an opportunity to be heard before the court passed this order.
Let's get to the root of the problem, Mr. Balgopal. You know, the root of the problem, is it the selection process itself? The collegium system, does it need to go? Is that where the problem really lies? You know, there's talk of a common entrance exam for judges at lower courts as well as they're planning to bring it for the higher courts as well. Is that going to change anything?
In fact, the collegium system already... A single judge in the said collegium has categorically stated that that is not the right system. So there is no difference of opinion on that. Having a common entrance exam like for bureaucracy is not going to improve the system either. You see the high courts. The district court judges are appointed by the high courts of that particular state.
Yes.
There should be a mixing of high court judges from other states also in the matter of appointment of district court judges. Judiciary in India is not Supreme Court and High Court alone. They are just a microscopic quantity of the actual judges, which constitutes magistrates, sub-judges, senior sub-judges, additional session judge, etc. So we have to see that area of selection is perfect. Most people do not go to the High Court and Supreme Court. They only heard about it. For them, justice is the court at the district level which they see. If purity is installed in that initial step, then that will travel up. Here, that selection process also, it becomes very questionable.
I'm sorry to cut you short, but how do we install that purity at that level? I mean, what you're saying makes a lot of sense,
yeah,
of course.
Purity we can instill here. That is in the selection of judges, not just by having a common entrance examination.
You're saying a holistic approach.
A holistic approach and involve in their selection the high court judges from neighboring states who know the language, who will be part of the selection committee to see that judges of a particular community which is requiring favor from a particular higher court judge does not happen and everything goes by merit. You clean that system, then it will spread from one step to the other. The most disparaging situation here is, like in Justice Karnan's contempt order is, tomorrow suppose there is a difference of opinion between one wing of judges along with another set of judges.
Yes.
And the same issue comes. Same issue comes that, see, that person has behaved like this. So is it that there is going to be contempt proceedings initiated by one wing against the other? So it is definitely a dangerous precedent. I feel that this matter should have been put to a quietus by permitting the judge to retire. More in view of the fact, the Supreme Court itself, as I had mentioned earlier, has come emphatically to the conclusion that the a prima facie it appears, he requires medical assistance. Even if a person who has committed murder, if he is not mentally sound, he is not hanged. So if a person does not know what he is saying, is bereft of that for any reason, that is what the suspicion or apprehension you have,
sure,
then you should have treated him that way. Now, by sending him to jail, perhaps you have ensured a fine political career of national eminence for the judge who has been sent to jail. I don't think this was what Supreme Court wanted.
Sure. You know, Satya Prakash, I'm going to take this point that Mr. Balgopal was making forward about, you know, this whether he was of sound mind or not. You know, a lot of people have been asking me, what is wrong with this justice? I mean, we've never seen something like this before. I because of lack of any other words, I'm going to say it as they have asked me. Is he mad or what is what many people have asked me.
See, throughout his judicial career, he has been sending the wrong signal to the top judges. Mm-hmm. They refuse to take that signal and act accordingly. Mm-hmm. That is where the problem lies. For several years, you have ignored his conduct. And all of a sudden, within a month or so, you are deciding the case like this. This is not the way forward. And certainly, it's a very dangerous precedent. Because tomorrow, forget about tomorrow, supposing there is a Supreme Court judge who says something or does something of the kind Justice Karnan has done. Will the Supreme Court judges, maybe five, six, seven or nine, they will sit together and decide like this? This is a dangerous precedent. The only course available to this collegium is, collegium was that, this would have recommended to Parliament. It's for Parliament to take a call. You take the copybook decision. This is what the provision says, so like this. Not that the power of contempt under Article 29 is certainly not to be used for this kind of situation.
Sure.
And maybe the Supreme Court has their power, and they have, to my understanding, they have misconstrued their power under Article 129 to be exercised against a sitting judge.
Fair enough. Ms. Jaisingh, has irreparable damage been done as far as the judiciary is concerned, looking into taking into consideration this entire saga?
Yes, let me tell you the real damage done. What I think the real damage is done to the independence of the judiciary, because the High Court is not subordinate to the Supreme Court in any sense of the word. And what this signal that has been put out by this judgment is that we sitting in the Supreme Court can sit in judgment over the conduct of a High Court judge, which means you are threatening the independence of the institution of the judiciary. It's over, it's finished. As I told you, tomorrow any other judge can live in terror of being accused of contempt of court. So that in terrorem aspect of this precedent is what destroys the independence of the judiciary, which the Constitution worked hard to ensure by ensuring a security of tenure for a judge. That's why the procedure for removal of the judge is so difficult. Now, it's a different matter that in this country we do not have a system of making a complaint against a judge short of impeachment. But for that, the failure has to be laid at the door of the Supreme Court and at the door of Parliament. We should have a law in this country where we should not think the Supreme Court has any right to come to any conclusion, prima facie or otherwise, about the mental condition of a judge. They can judge his behavior. They can say his behavior amounts to an act of misconduct, but no one can be compelled to undergo a medical examination. And if the judge refuses to undergo a medical examination, he has done nothing wrong, because the Supreme Court itself has said that for any procedure to be performed on you, you require the informed consent of the person who has to undergo that procedure.
Sure.
He did not consent to undergoing any such procedure. There's no point in telling me a person is mad. I'm not interested in knowing. What I'm interested in knowing is his conduct an act of misconduct? If it is, take action in accordance with law.
A lot of sense
why
you're making there with
it,
your
you
point.
You can't go at his mind to decide, to find out why he took that, why he behaved in the way he behaved.
Sure.
It's no concern of yours.
Sure. You know, I've got about 4 minutes left on the program, so I'm going to get quick closing comments from all my guests. Justice Dhingra, what's the way forward, really, for the judiciary?
First, judiciary should not be considered above law. What is being proposed is that a judge is, you see, independence of judiciary is not a license to abuse. What is being proposed is that a judge, once he becomes a judge, he becomes above law. And he can abuse, he can commit crime, he can do anything. Nobody can do anything because he can be removed only by impeachment. And parliament in our country has shown its incompetency in impeachment. Mm. Not once, but and it has not impeached so far any judge. So, judge becomes law unto himself. He says, I will abuse, I will say that you are doing wrong, you are passing wrong judgment, I am sentencing you to 7 years. You see, a high court judge, he is not under Supreme Court judge. So he can sentence Supreme Court judge to 7 years, 10 years. So let his judgment be carried. He can sentence any advocate also to 10 years because yes. He advocate came into my court and he quarreled with me. So he committed my contempt, I sentence him to 10 years. So if you give this power to judge and say that he should not be removed because sending him to jail amounts to removal, that would send a message that we have two kinds of law. One, which an ordinary man, if he even writes an article or conducts a survey about the, probity of the judges, he is threatened with contempt and he has to apologize or to go to jail.
Sure.
And a judge can do anything. So that means that we are actually traversing constitution, showing that this constitution is not meant for a higher level of excellence than it is meant for lower, only common man.
I'm sorry to cut
I'm
you
sorry,
short.
This should not be the message.
Because I've just got 1 minute, so very quickly, Mr. Balgopal.
Here actually, judicial ego should not pep up contempt proceedings.
Okay.
Here, I'll just take half a minute here. Justice Denning was holding court with another fellow judge and a lady came and started throwing tomatoes at him. She had decided a case against her and out of frustration she was throwing this tomato. Fellow judge said we should initiate contempt against her.
Okay.
He said wait, let her frustration come out. Let's not use contempt for this. Contempt, we need a little bit of benevolence also and let it have a human face.
That's very
valid. Let it not be vindictive.
Yes, that's a very valid point that you're making. Don't be vindictive. Let it have a valid face. Indra Jaisingh, please close the show for us with your quick concluding remark.
See, we are living in times where a lot of institutions of society are being eroded. At such a point, we turn to the Supreme Court to uphold the laws of the land. And if we find that the Supreme Court itself is giving a go-by to the laws of the land, it really is very, very painful. This is the time when the Supreme Court has to rise above its own, as somebody said, petty egos and make sure that the law of the land is respected by the court itself. Okay. We look forward to that.
Okay, on that note, then I'll have to call it a wrap. Okay, yes, very, very quickly.
And it is not...
Appointments.
It okay, is we, not my... I want to just tell you...
Judges. And this current system of collegium, it's completely faulty. We need to give it a quietus.
Okay. I'm really sorry, Ms. Jaisingh. I'm completely out of time on the program today, so I'll have to call it a wrap at that. That's all the time we have. Thank you to all my guests. See you again next time.